1998-99 year. It's October 12th, 1998. We have the roll call by the town clerk, please.
Chairman Groff.
Here.
Counselor Barry.
Here.
Counselor Fritz.
Here.
Counselor McGinty.
Here.
Counselor Reed.
Here.
And Counselor Watson.
Here.
We have the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag.
Where's the flag?
Visible flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I don't believe we have any presentations tonight, do we, Mr. McGovern?
No, but there will be one next month, which I'll mention under manager's report.
All right. Counselors' reports and correspondence?
Mr. Chairman, as far as the county, the Budget Advisory Committee, we've had several meetings, and they're heading down toward the final budget. I think that the jail overtime budget is unfortunately huge, and I hope that can be addressed, because there's about $300,000 worth of overtime they're looking at, which might be managed through some personnel adjustment there. And the county clerk has resigned, is going to Derry, New Hampshire as the town manager there, so we'll be getting new county manager, and the three county commissioners are going to have to deal with that county budget, but I hope that something can be worked out with the jail. The rest of the departments we have all gone over piece by piece, and we've tried to economize as much as possible, because the town of Cape Elizabeth has to pay over $500,000 a year to the county to keep that running. So we've been working on it, and that will be finalized by the end of the year.
Thank you. Are there any other councilors? Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I would just like to remind the public that we are interviewing members of the public to serve on the boards and commissions, and if anybody is interested in knowing more about the openings, they could call Barbara Ray at the town hall or myself at 767-0718. Thank you.
Anyone else? Next is the town manager's report. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, first of all, I'd like to explain the absence of the flag this morning. I don't know why I keep thinking it's morning. This evening.
You're really going to have people confused.
No, I know.
Later, early.
This past weekend out at Sugarloaf, or up at Sugarloaf, David Pickering, our chief of police, was installed as the president of the Maine Chiefs of Police Association. And as part of that ceremony, we had a color guard from our local police department who participated in the ceremony as volunteers in order to salute their chief and to reflect that that was a very important occasion. I do wish to congratulate David on his election and installation as the president, and know that he'll do a tremendous job for that association and continue to do a good job for the town. Beyond that, I think most of you are aware I was away on vacation last week, but I did want to make note of the newspaper article that I saw in relation to the storm and some kids down on Salisbury Lane. I think I don't know all the details of it, haven't spoken to the public safety personnel, but I think it's important to note that at the scene was a member of our fire police unit, Stan Saunce, and that is indicative of all of the volunteers that we have working for the community, from fire police to rescue to the WET team to our volunteer firefighters, call firefighters. There are so many people who come forward during an event like that. Really appreciative that Stan was there at that scene where his help was needed, as well as all the other folks that helped out with the storm over the weekend.
Thank you. We have the minutes of our September 14th, 1998 meeting. Is there a motion in that regard? Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I'll move acceptance as written.
Second.
All in favor? Unanimous, 6-0. We now have a public hearing concerning the November 3rd vote on the pool referendum. Perhaps prior to the hearing, our town manager could give a brief statement that will again inform the citizenry of why this question is in fact on the ballot, and frame the question somewhat so people can have a better appreciation before they hear anyone else comment. Mr. McGovern.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The school department and a committee of the town first began to look at the pool early in 1996. It was obvious that there was beginning to be quite a bit of wear and tear in the pool. It is about 25 years old. There are a number of safety issues as well. There's been two committees that have looked at the pool since that time, as well as the town council and the school board. As a result of the first committee's work, a second committee was formed that has really looked more specifically at the pool, and then that committee forward a recommendation to the town council. The proposal is for a project that would, in essence, totally renovate the room where the pool itself is located. That would be a totally new pool basin that would be up to current standards, and many other changes within that room. There'd also be spectator seating added. Many of you are aware, if you've ever been to an event at the pool, that the spectators now come in onto the pool deck, and it's very awkward and unsafe. There would be a new weight room constructed, new exercise room for the use of citizens. There would be renovated locker rooms. If any of you have been in those locker rooms, you can see that they do need some work. In addition, right now, all the filtering equipment for the swimming pool is down in a lower level, sort of below the pool, below the pool offices. There's only one way in and out of that room. It's by a ladder. It's very unsafe for any personnel that go down there, particularly with the dangerous chemicals. All of this would cost $2.2 million. That's the amount that's shown on the ballot. It would be paid for over approximately 20 years, so that the cost of it would be much less to citizens each year. It will be the only local issue on the ballot, in addition to the town council election and a Portland Water District election on that particular ballot. A yes vote will be in favor of spending the $2.2 million and in favor of going forward with the renovations. A no vote would be opposed to having that occur.
Thank you. We now have the public hearing, and any member of the public that wishes to speak on this issue, if you would come to the microphone, the podium, and please identify yourself and give your address. Is there anyone that wishes to speak at this time? Come on up, Barney.
I'm Barney Hintley, and I live at 8 Park Circle. I'm a member of the pool committee, and I'm quite impressed with the number of people that we have here tonight. Nevertheless, our able chairman, Dave Sear, called me this afternoon and said, Barney, said, I'm under the weather. Can you go and represent the committee? So I'm here not only representing the committee, but also myself as a citizen. And I guess the first thing I'd say is if all of the members of the council haven't seen our newly minted brochure, I'd be happy to pass it out to you. It gives some of the facts that Mike just gave in a summary form, and let me give it to you. Yep. Needless to say, our committee has spent a significant amount of time analyzing this issue, analyzing the problems, identifying the options, studying the options from a cost perspective as well as from a functional perspective to get it done. We are very much in favor of having this work go forward. We have worked very hard at this. We think it is a good thing for the town and its citizens and will benefit this town for many, many years to come. That's my statement. I'm sure I speak for everybody else on the committee.
Barney, while you're still up, I mean, on behalf of the town council, I'll thank you for all your time and effort, and in thanking you, I'm also attempting to thank everyone else on the committee. Mm-hmm. I think the council received this report. Many of us have dealt with this issue for years now, and we're particularly impressed with the thoroughness and the work, the just pure work of this committee. It was a great group, And it's only because of people like you and all the co-members in the committee that we really are able to take critical looks at many of these issues that face us. And I know, on behalf of all the councilors, thank you, and please convey our thanks to all members of the committee.
Well, thank you very much, Joe. I will certainly do that, and I will tell you that everybody on this committee was very conscientious. They worked real hard, and they put in the time not only to study the issues very carefully, in recognition that we know that this is a large capital outlay for the town, but also in putting the report together, we all worked very hard, and it was a real team effort.
Thank you. Councilor Reed.
Just as the appointments chair, I'd like to say that we've never had twice as many people as we needed applicants for come out for a committee that was and really an interim committee, and we thank you for that. And also I want to point out that with one changeover, all the people who had served on the committee will serve on a successor committee if this referendum passes. So I just wanted to let the public know that we have a core of very interested people willing to do the work. And I also wanted to highlight for 1 minute that with this pool referendum, there's also a potential to raise revenue that we do not have in the current pool as it sits. And I just wanted to have that restated during the public hearing so that people who may have missed that on one of the other times through understands that there are revenue opportunities with some of these improvements that do not currently exist today.
Councilor Reed, that is absolutely correct. And Sue and some of us really worked quite hard to identify and gather that data and to make sure that we really thought it could happen, and I think that we do. Is that fair statement, Sue? Yeah. Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
You're very welcome.
Is there anyone else who wishes to speak tonight? Seeing no one else, declare the public hearing closed. I think this is the last time before the election that the public would have an opportunity to hear any counselor on this issue, and I propose to allot a minute to any counselor who wishes to speak to let the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, if at your own choosing, your views on this subject, if to the extent that that might help someone else decide. So anybody, any counselors who wish to speak. Councilor Watson.
Chairman, I would urge everybody to come out to the polls on November 3rd and vote on this issue. Vote favorably for this. It's very important for our town, for our cross-section of citizens, from our youth to our young children who are just learning how to swim, to our senior citizens who are using the pool for rehabilitative purposes. I think it's important that this pass. I would hate to see the pool close. I think that we would be remiss as a town in losing this very valuable asset. And I would hope that everybody would come forward and vote on this, because I think it's important. I do believe, sincerely believe, that we have a chance to generate some revenue to offset some of the cost. But more importantly, I think that this is significant to our town.
Councilor Reed.
Yes, I would also urge a yes vote on this on November 3rd from the general public. I served on the committee that led to the committee that became the committee that recommended that we do this. So it was very obvious to us some time ago that repairs for safety reasons were very obvious. And I think it's more of an issue without trying to scare people. This is a very valuable community asset which could be lost if we do not do what we have to do in the next few months to get it up to code.
Councilor Fritz.
Yes, I'd just like to say that I think this is a very important community facility that's for use for the entire community, not just the school children, but elderly and all ages. And I would like to thank Sue Weatherby particularly for all the work that she's done in putting together the numbers and being conservative in her estimates of the costs and the amount of revenue that is there is potential for in this project.
Councilor McGinty.
For all the same reasons that everyone else has articulated, I also support this and encourage everyone to come out and vote in favor of this. Also, is this report available at the library also?
Yes.
Yes, okay. And I hope that anybody who has any concerns, that they'll take a look at it, see the good job that the committee did, and how well they've laid out exactly what the town needs and how we can get there. And I just might add that if this doesn't pass, it's still going to cost us $500,000 to close the pool, and I think that would be a ludicrous expense. So I hope everyone will come out and support this.
Councilor Barry.
I add my voice to the rest of the councilors. We have met with the pool committee, who have done such a good job and prepared a report that was very impressive, giving us several alternatives or several choices. And this is the proposal set before us is the one that makes sense. As John has just said, it will cost $500,000 just to fill it with sand, and that doesn't make any sense at all. The valuable community asset that this pool provides for the senior citizens to the toddlers should not be lost, and I hope that everybody will vote yes for the pool. We're going to pay, well, if you divide $2.2 million over 20 years, I come up with about $110,000 a year, and the revenues will offset some of that. And I think this is a valuable asset that the community must not lose. And so let's support the pool and vote yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I know our prior chair, Bill Beyer, was very much in favor of the pool. He was very active on the pool committee, and I would be remiss if I didn't remind everyone that he was a strong advocate for this program. I also support the pool. Henry, I believe the cost is a little more than that because of interest, but it's still a cost well worthwhile. What it really does, if you have a $150,000 home, it's approximately $30 a year of your cost, about $30 a year to pay off this bond. There really aren't a lot of other options. This was a remarkable group that studied this proposal. They worked hard. They came up with the best solution. I think it's important to note that the fact that the pool has a problem now is no one's fault. We have other things in this town where we might not have taken care of things properly. That's not the pool. The pool is at the end of its useful life. It was state of the art when it was built. We got good value when we built it, but things wear out over a period of time. What's great about this new proposed pool is that the estimated life of this pool, because of new construction techniques and new ways of building pools, is double the life of the old pool. So this isn't just an investment for the 20-year length of the bond. I mean, this is a pool that's going to be here a long time. And I know this community well enough after living here most of my adult life now that when there's good value and it makes sense, people support things, and this is good value, and it makes sense. And I hope everyone comes out and votes for this, votes for the pool. Well, that ties right into our next item, which is item number 51, an action to set polling hours for November 3rd. Madam Clerk.
Thank you, Chairman Groff. As everyone knows now, we are voting on Tuesday, November 3rd. The council has already approved the warrant and the polling hours for the local issues. I'd like to have the same polling hours for the general issues and referendum issues at the state level. We propose that the polls open at 7 a.m., and of course they close at 8 p.m., and if I could just say that anyone that cannot be at the election on Tuesday, November 3rd, absentee ballots are now available. You may come to Town Hall or give the town clerk's office a call, and we'll make sure that we get a ballot to you.
And do you need a motion, I take it?
I would, yes, like one, thank you.
Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we set the polling hours for November 3rd from 7 a.m. until 8 o'clock p.m.
Is there a second?
Second.
Councilor Berry seconds. All in favor? It's unanimous. Moving on to item 52, to consider approval of student election clerks. Again, our town clerk steps forward.
Thank you very much. A couple of years ago, the state law allowed us to use student election clerks when necessary. 17-year-olds can serve at the polls or assist on elections. This year, we have two students that would like to serve, Stacy Pickering and Eric Messerschmidt. These two students will be helping me. Eric will be helping me before the election, doing absentee balloting and voter registration. Stacy will be helping me set up for the election and on election day. So I would recommend that the council approve these two students, and they both will receive school credits for their participation.
So moved.
Second.
It's moved by Councilor Fritz, seconded by Councilor McGinty. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? It's unanimous, 6-0. Item number 54. item number 53. Consider approval of pilot program establishing two non-voting student representatives to the town council. We have discussed this item at workshop, and this has been one of, I believe, one of our council goals this year, and Councilor Watson has been in charge of this endeavor. So, Ruth?
Chairman Groff, I had a meeting on Monday, September 28th, at the high school with the advisor for the student council and all the student council members, David Perry. Peter Dawson was also in and out, as well as Kevin Sweeney from the school board attended to show his support for this this endeavor to have student representatives to the town council. As people may be aware, we do have two student representatives to the school board. So that is something that's already in the works, and this is just kind of building on that, if you will, as well as, I think, in some respects, building upon the student election clerks as taking one more step of involving our youth in our town government. And one I think that I know from having met with the youth, they're very excited about this opportunity and are taking it very seriously, have a great deal of enthusiasm about it, and hope that we pass this tonight and that we can move forward and have some representation. This would also fulfill, every senior takes government, and they have a requirement to do a field study. This would serve as a field study requirement for them. So they would get some credit for their time served here, as well as just be a great community participation. I don't know if you would like me to read the statement of purpose and responsibilities, but it's clear. I'd be happy to do that if you think that's necessary.
I don't. If another member of the town council did, I think it's important to note for the public that this is not an elected position, and for that reason, student representatives do not vote. They also are not in attendance at executive session. So that there are many forms of participation, but I wouldn't want any citizen to come away with the understanding that appointed student representatives are somehow casting votes on individuals' taxes or are considering sensitive information. They will be exposed to the same information that any member of the public would be exposed to. Is that correct?
That's correct. And they will be attending an orientation session to understand the council and chamber protocols and to understand how town government works. They also will make a commitment to attend the meetings and executive sessions as much as possible. I mean, not executive sessions, and the workshops. They will not attend executive sessions and the workshops as their time permits on various various subjects. So we anticipate that they will have a seating space either in the front row or on the side, so they will be designated as student representatives. We also anticipate that should there be interest on their part to speak on a particular item on the agenda, that they would be so recognized by the chairman. One of the students did suggest something that I thought was fairly interesting. These students are going to be nominated by the student government, but then that nomination will be anointed, if you will, by the principal and by David Perry. And one of the students suggested that when they get a pool of people together that have a desire to serve in this capacity, that they then present their reasons for wanting to serve on the town council as a student representative in front of the entire student body, and then the student council, and as well as maybe the student body, will vote on who they should select. So they've thought through this pretty well, and I think we'll see some excellent representation. I also should note, let everyone know, that this is a pilot project that we are doing only for this year. We hope and anticipate that it will be successful and will follow through to each subsequent year, but of course that depends upon the composition of the council.
Do any councilors, now I take it that you've now made a motion in accord with item 53 that's in all our packets, student representatives to the town council, statement of purpose and responsibilities?
Yes.
Which I'll second.
Second by Councilor Reed. Is a discussion of this proposal. Councilor Berry.
Just a quick question. Is that for this school year or this calendar year or what?
The school year.
The school year until the end of June?
But the school year sort of runs with our council year.
Okay.
So, you know, I think there's, that seemed to be what made sense.
Thank you.
Further question? All right. Since there appears to be no further discussion, we'll have a vote. All in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous, 6-0. Councilor Watson, thank you very much on behalf of the entire council for your work in this effort. I think it's another indication where the council is trying to reach out and be inclusive, not exclusive. And hopefully the town will benefit, the council will benefit, and the students that participate in this program will also benefit.
Thank you.
Item 54. Approval of liquor license and special amusement permit for the Paputa Club. I've always wondered what this special amusement permit is, so that's why, Mr. McGovern, why don't you address
it? Don't ask.
Oh, Debbie's going to do this.
So they can dance.
Oh, okay.
This is a renewal license for the Paputa Club for a malt, spirituous, and vinyl liquor license. Our local ordinance does not require a public hearing on this. However, we always check with public safety, and Chief Pickering does not have any objections to the approval of this renewal for either license.
Is the application in order?
Yes, it is.
I move the approval of the license.
Second.
Been moved and seconded for the approval of the liquor license and special amusement permit for the Paputa Club. I think since I'm a member, I will abstain.
Mr.
Discussion?
Chairman, I think I, as also as a member, should abstain. So.
All right.
Well, how lucky four of us aren't.
We can vote.
We can vote and pass it.
All in favor? Passes 4-0 with 2 abstentions.
Mr. Chairman, just as a point of order, not to belabor this point, but are we supposed to get permission from our fellow councilors to abstain in a vote? Is that the
I think you're supposed to. I think you're supposed to vote on an item unless there is reason where you could have a conflict. Mm-hmm. I don't think a conflict, if you wanted to vote and you had a conflict, I think you'd have to lay it out for your fellow councilors.
Right.
If, in fact, you have a possible conflict and you do not vote for that reason, I don't think you need the approval of the other councilors to recuse yourself. But I do believe you're right, that if I wanted to vote on this issue, I think I would be duty-bound to raise the fact that I was a member of Paputic and but didn't feel there was a conflict. And
that was my understanding. Thank you.
item 55. Consider approval of the use of Fort Williams Park on August 7th, 1999 for finish line activities of the People's Beach to Beacon 10K Road Race. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, this is a request for a year two of the road race. The letter that we received from Joan Benoit Samuelson and Dave Weatherby, the chairman of the board and the board president respectively, indicates that the request is also for the Saturday in the years 2000, 2001, 2, and 3. When the Fort Williams Commission reviewed this request, they gave permission for the 1999 event. They indicated that they would reserve on the schedule the first Saturday of August through the year 2003, but they left open the possibility and said that they would request further approvals for succeeding years, since the commission changes, since the council changes, and since it's only been a one-year event, and it'll have its truer test over time.
Is there a motion in this regard? Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I move that the town council give permission to use Fort Williams as a finish site for the Beach to Beacon race on August 7th, 1999, and that the first Saturday of August be held open for the event as a scheduling matter each year through and including the year 2003, subject to the approval of the event each year in accordance with the usual approval procedures.
Second the motion.
Seconded by Councilor Barry. Discussion. Anyone? Oh, I think under discussion, I'll say that Julia Kirtland, who stayed with me, finished 14th among all women in the world in the Chicago Marathon this last weekend. So I'm very much in favor of this. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? Opposed? It passes 6-0. Item 56, consider approval of the use of Fort Williams Park on July 31st, 1999 for the Concours d'Elegance, is that right?
That's right.
Of the National Vintage Triumph Owners Convention. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, we've had a number of similar events at Fort Williams Park over the years. I think probably the best known was the Porsche Club, who had actually two events several years back. There's been a number of other car events. There's been a couple of motorcycle events. This is a National Triumph Owners Convention. It's supposed to bring quite a bit to the greater Portland economy. What the group appeared before the Fort Williams Advisory Commission, they had with them, interestingly enough, a representative of the Convention and Visitors Bureau who was there to stress the importance of this to the greater Portland business community. The Fort Williams Advisory Commission, when they did review this, the vote was 6-1. The member who was opposed to it felt that Fort Williams has a potential of being overused, recognizing that this is the week following the Fort Williams Centennial and the week preceding the Beach to Beacon Road Race. Nonetheless, the other six members felt that it was an excellent use of the park and that they believe it's good to help out the economy in Greater Portland with events such as this.
Is there a fee paid for this?
Yeah. They pay a fee per vehicle, plus they pay all the town's expenses. It was when the Fort Williams Advisory Commission approved this, they left open the possibility that the current per vehicle fee might be revised.
Is there a motion in this regard?
I'll move that the use of Fort Williams Park on July 31st, 1999 for the Concours d'Elegance of the National Vintage Triumph Owners Convention be approved. And then I have a question if it's seconded.
Is there a second? Councilor Watson.
I have a question, Mr. Chairman, on the insurance coverage for the town. There could be some liability here, and I think that we ought to have at least $500,000 limit for liability insurance, and perhaps Mr. McGovern, as the manager, can attend to that detail. I think that should be included in any plans for this event, with the town to be named as an insured at their expense.
Yeah, the only issue I have with that, and again, it's a technical issue, is under our own policy and I'm just trying to recall with our own tort waiver, with our own statute in the state, where if you have insurance, you're liable. If you don't have insurance, you're not up past the caps. And
about
so
300,000.
Yeah. So the you know, setting a high cap sometimes is self-defeating. Now, I would rather see it that what the council is the sense of the council that we have appropriate insurance coverage, but I think there are some technical issues in setting that at certain amounts that might end up hurting us rather than helping us is all I'm saying.
Well, as you correctly point out, that if you have insurance, liability insurance with a carrier, then the carrier is obliged to defend the town and they waive any consideration of municipal immunity or the Maine Tort Claims Act limit of 300,000. But if they have more, I see the possibility of a whole lot of very expensive cars coming into the fort, and I don't know what the exposure for liability would be. I'm just concerned that the town be protected, that's all.
And I'm very much in accord with your sentiments. I'm just reluctant to sit here tonight without a specific understanding of what would be the right number or what best way to protect the town, to hamstring the town manager in any regard in carrying out our wishes that the town be fully insured in the event of any problems.
If we have a $10,000 insurance policy and we have a big claim, that's not going to help the town.
Yeah, we routinely require any and all groups who utilize Fort Williams, with the exception of those at the picnic shelter, to provide to us a certificate of liability insurance that at a minimum is at the limits of the Maine Tort Claims Act. We do accept larger insurance coverages from those that have existing coverage. We are listed as a named insured on all of those policies.
Oh, that's fine.
Councilor McGinty.
This is a one-time event. This is not a recurring event.
That's correct.
Okay. I do have some concern with the number. They say they expect 300 to 400 cars. And, you know, I'm going to defer to the Fort William Advisory Committee. They supported this. I'm sure they asked all these questions about what kind of environmental damage could be done. Presuming these cars are going to be parked on the field or something, the parade ground, I presume. But I will defer to them. I do have a concern about that. I guess I'll support this.
Councilor Reed.
I'll be supporting the motion, but I also have a concern regarding the $2 per car entry fee as being low. And I was just wondering who makes the determination on that entry fee? Is it per event, or is it stated in the Fort Williams policy about regardless of the event, that's the parking fee?
There is a statement of Fort Williams large group policy that lays out the event. It was approved by the town council. When the Fort Williams Commission reviewed this, they did indicate that prior to this event, they want to take a look at that in conjunction with the town council goal to be looking at all of those types of issues in Fort Williams Park.
Thank you.
Further discussion?
From the minutes, there was a suggestion that they might be part of the centennial celebration, and I wasn't clear whether they actually agreed to do that.
The meeting was a meeting of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission and not of the Fort Williams Centennial Committee. It's, they're differing groups. So, yeah, it was just a suggestion.
Further discussion?
I'd just like to point out that it's obvious that the chairman is not fluent in French.
Yeah. Well, that's what happens when you live with a woman who's a translator. That part of me shuts down. My wife at home probably expected me to butcher that. Is there further discussion? Hearing none, I'll call vote. All in favor? It passes 6-0. Item 57, consider approval of appendices to the General Assistance Ordinance. Mr. McGovern.
Yes. Excuse me. Every year, the Maine Municipal Association, at the behest of the Maine Department of Human Services, sends out maximum amounts for general assistance. It's been routine that we adopt the recommended levels that come down from the Department of Human Services via the Maine Municipal Association.
Is there a motion?
I move that it be adopted.
Second.
Moved in by Councilor Barry, seconded by Councilor McGinty, that we approve the appendices to the General Assistance Ordinance. Discussion? Hearing none, all in favor? 6-0. We're on a roll tonight. Item 58, approval of ballot for annual Maine Municipal Association election. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, I was very happy this year to serve on the nominating committee of the Maine Municipal Association, and the candidates before you are the mayor of Auburn for vice president, Peggy Daigle, the administrative assistant in East Millinocket, automatically becomes the president. I'm not sure why they put her on the ballot. The executive committee member is the town, proposed the town manager of Vassalboro. And then for the executive committee, three council members, select folks. Mike Obey, who is a councilor for the city of Bangor, a former commissioner of the Department of Economic and Community Development. Mm. Marie Saucier from Glenburn, I have one of those names. And Richard Scott, councilor in Presque Isle.
And I assume as member of the nominating committee, you were satisfied with all the nominees?
They look to be very fine people. Didn't know them all. I know three or four of them seemed like good people.
Is there a motion in this regard? Councilor Watson.
Make a motion that we approve the ballot for the annual Maine Municipal Association elections as designated.
Second?
Yeah.
Well,
I have a question.
I had a question, too.
Uh-oh.
All right. Just so I understand, the motion was basically to approve...
The form?
Yeah, what are we approving?
You should be approving the executive committee, and I don't see it here, but the advisory committee as well, the five individuals who I didn't mention either, but I would cast the ballot and take it to the meeting. That's what your question. Let me mention briefly, Peter Wass, who's the chair of the Board of Selectmen of Cherryfield, Wendy Hanscom, no relation to any local Hanscoms, the selectman in Newry, Nat Tupper, the manager in Yarmouth, Alan Bean, the manager in Holton, and Jim Catlin, the manager in Brownville, are also proposed to go on the advisory committee.
And this particular motion basically now casts the vote of this municipality for these individuals listed on the ballot. Is that correct?
That's right.
And that was the intent of your motion.
Yes.
Is there a second to that motion?
Why don't you authorize the town clerk to cast the ballot?
We will do that as part of the motion.
I accept that.
All right. Is there a second to the amended motion?
I'll second that.
Councilor Berry, further discussion about the motion?
So we're not approving the form, we're approving the people.
The people.
That's right.
We're casting our ballot
right.
for all these individuals. Hearing no further discussion, all in favor? Opposed? 6-0. This could set an all-time record.
Too clear.
Item 59, approval of pole location on Two Lights Road. Now, before anybody else asks, I'll pretend I'm Councilor Jordan and say, Mr. McGovern, is the pole already up?
I haven't checked.
All right, now we can consider this. Mr. McGovern, why don't you tell us about this item?
Yeah, this is the pole location just down below Beacon Lane. It's in conjunction with a permit that was approved earlier by the planning board.
Yeah.
Is there a motion? Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I move approval of the pole location on Two Lights Road as stated.
Your second?
Second.
Councilor McGinty.
Question.
Further discussion?
This says the New England Telephone and Telegraph Company. Have they been replaced by Bell Atlantic? I don't know.
They still use the corporate name for purposes of pole locations of New England Telephone and Telegraph
Thank you.
Company.
Thank you.
That's going to be my question.
Further discussion? Hearing none. All in favor? It passes unanimously. This is quite an evening. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. I don't think any of our citizens out there coming forward. Is there a motion for adjournment?
I move we adjourn, Mr. Chairman.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to adjourn to allow me to travel tonight to Caribou. All in favor?
Bon voyage.
6-0.
1 point. While I was away last week, a meeting has been scheduled on the boundary issue. I think all of the councilors were consulted about the date. It's October 22nd.
Right.
For anyone who's on the South Pole, it was the boundary. It'll be a public meeting to discuss the findings of that boundary.
Where is it?
Survey. It's here in Cape Elizabeth at the town hall.
What time?
7:30.
I haven't seen the notice. Actually, I did see it, but I
think it's
7:30.
I think it was 7:30.
If anyone, it'll be posted on the web page. If anyone wishes to
we'll,
a we'll
question.
Also be sending notice out on the website, notice out to all those on the boundary.
And will we receive information regarding?
We'll receive a reminder, yes.
Well, no, information regarding the findings prior to the meeting.
Good answer.
Let me show you.
There are three areas that the surveyors found where there was some question about boundary, and they reviewed them all.
We had a very good meeting with the consultant on the issue of boundary.
Very interesting.
It's been moved and seconded that we adjourn, and it's been voted unanimously to adjourn, so we are adjourned. Good evening.
I have...